Good afternoon, all. I welcome you all to the CCR of Medicine Unit 1. So the case will be presented by Dr. Karthik Agarwal, and the discussion will be carried on by Dr. Adil.
Good afternoon, everyone. Let's begin with the case. We have a patient who is a 59-year-old gentleman and who is resident of Fatehpur, Uttar Pradesh. And by occupation, he is a civil engineer and involved in road construction work. And his last visit to the site was on 29th August in the nearby area only. And by diet, he is vegetarian. And this patient was admitted to our hospital in early days of October with the complaints of fever for last 1 month, along with the nausea and vomiting for last 10 days. The fever that he had for last 4 weeks was basically intermittent in nature. And the intensity of fever gradually increased up to 105 degree Fahrenheit. And the fever episodes were associated with the chills, and there was no particular diurnal variation in the fever pattern. And there was some symptomatic improvement in the fever by antipyretic medications. And along with the fever, he had nausea and vomiting. He had multiple episodes of non-bilious vomiting, and that was non-projectile in nature. And the vomitus consisted of eaten food particles, and there was no blood in vomitus. So coming to negative history, actually there was no history of headache, altered mental status, blurring of vision or seizure, and no history of night sweats, bony pain, ear pain, or any kind of discharge from the ear canal. And no history of cough, chest pain, shortness of breath, palpitations, or chin cough. And no history of abdominal pain, abdominal distension, loose stools, jaundice, or any kind of burning while micturition. And no history of a photosensitivity, skin rash, oral ulcer, skin thickening, joint pain, or dry eye or dry mouth. And no past history of TB, and also no history of TB in the family. And no history of any kind of blood transfusion in the past. And for this febrile illness, the patient was actually evaluated in the outside hospital from 15th to 30th September. And meanwhile, he also received a course of antibiotics, but there was no improvement in the fever. So coming to the past history, patient basically had history of recurrent left-sided ureteric calculi, and for which he underwent PCNL twice. And also, he's a known case of hypertension since 2006, but that was well controlled on medication, basically on telmisartan. And he also had bronchial asthma since last 20 years, but now he was completely asymptomatic and off treatment. And among the personal history, patient actually complained of a decreased appetite since he had fever. And also there was a history of a significant weight loss of around 6 kg in last 1 month, with a normal sleep pattern and normal bowel and bladder habits, and no history of any kind of illicit or over-the-counter drug use, and no history of a smoking or alcohol intake, and no history of any pets at home or any kind of other animal exposure. So summarizing the history, that we have a patient who had a fever for last 4 weeks along with the nausea and vomiting, and with the significant history of weight loss and anorexia. So based on this history, actually it's difficult to localize what exactly the cause of fever. So let's move on the examination part. In the general examination, actually the patient was found to be febrile with a fever of 102 degree Fahrenheit, along with this slight tachycardia and slight tachypnea. That might be because of a febrile illness. And apart from that, there was nothing significant. And in head-to-toe examination, actually there was no kind of a skin rash or eschar, or no temporal wasting, and oral cavity is also found to be completely normal, and no tenderness over paranasal sinuses, and no dilated vein or any kind of limb swelling, and there was no splinter hemorrhages or Janeway lesions or osteolar nodes. And fundus examination was also done, that revealed actually grade 1 hypertensive retinopathy only. Moving on to systemic examination, actually all the systems were found to be completely up to the mark. Apart from that, there was mild hepatomegaly, and the liver was palpable up to one finger breadth below the right subcostal margin. So summarizing the case, that our patient had a fever of 4 weeks along with the nausea and vomiting for 10 days with the significant weight loss and anorexia, along with the only significant finding in examination was that there was hepatomegaly. So like any patient of a febrile illness, we kept our broad differentials of either it could be infective or neoplastic or can be inflammatory disorder. So let's have a look on the investigations that were done in the outside hospital. In the routine investigation, there was a mild to moderate anemia along with the slightly elevated liver enzymes, with the elevated inflammatory markers in the form of a CRP, and urine routine and procalcitonin was totally up to normal. And apart from that, some special investigations were also done that included dengue malaria along with the blood and urine culture, the scrub typhus and CMV RT-PCR along with the HIV antibody and other viral markers, and everything was found to be negative. So apart from that, a few radiological investigations were also done in the outside hospital, And there was a CT report. Actually, we didn't have the film of that CT. And in that report, there was mild hepatomegaly along with the perinephric fat standing. And ultrasound abdomen and 2D echo also found to be normal. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Rachna ma'am from radiology department to discuss the MRI findings then that were done in the outside hospital.
Very good afternoon, everyone. We are having this outside MRI scan of this patient. So these sections are at the level of abdomen, at the level of liver. So on this, the very first image of axial non-fat cell T1 weighted images, we can see that there is no as such hepatic vessels within the liver and the spleen. And the second row is of a T2 fat set, and the third row is a T2 non-fat set images, in which as such there is no hepatic vessels seen within the liver and the spleen. The first image is a coronal fat cell T2 weighted image, in which we can see that there is simple renal cyst in the left kidney. And apart from that, there is no as such perinephric fat standing and no lesion seen within the liver and the spleen. The second row is a axial CT section at the level of liver. So as if there is no liver abscess or splenic abscess or any other focal lesion was seen within the liver and the spleen. These are the cut section of the lung window. In the axial and the coronal section, bilateral lung parenchyma appears normal and bronchovascular markings also appear normal. So basically this pattern where imaging is normal and the patient is having histoplasmosis is described in literature, and the cause for increased uptake in PET is basically the underlying active inflammation within the liver. And this pattern in which there is active uptake in the PET scan is also seen in case of leukemia, lymphoma, metastasis and tuberculosis.
Thank you, ma'am. So after admission, we actually also repeated few routine investigations, and what that revealed that there was persistent moderate anemia with the increased inflammatory markers. So likely because of some chronic illness only, along with that some iron deficiency component. And apart from that, there were elevated liver enzymes in the form of a cholestatic pattern. So finally, summarizing the case that and the clinical findings, as I already told you. So the only important thing among the investigation part was that there were raised liver enzymes along with the inflammatory markers with the moderate anemia, and there was a doubtful perinephric fat standing in the outside CT report. So based on these findings, we were able to narrow down our differentials to either it could be a chronic granulomatous hepatitis or it could be pyelonephritis. So let's have a look on the points which are in favor or against our differential diagnosis. So for granulomatous hepatitis, actually the patient had a fever along with the significant weight loss with the hepatomegaly, and they disproportionately increased ALP levels with increased inflammatory markers, but it's kind of a rare entity. And for the pyelonephritis, the patient had a fever with the history of recurrent ureteric calculi and a doubtful perinephric fat standing and the increased inflammatory markers. But the strong point which are against for pyelonephritis was that there were no genetic urinary complaints to the patient, along with the normal urine routine examination and the culture reports with the normal MR abdomen finding. So after all this, we kept our working diagnosis of granulomatous hepatitis only. So let's have a look on the possible etiology for granulomatous hepatitis. So broadly, we can categorize the etiology, either it can be infectious etiology or can be primary liver disease, or inflammatory disorder, or neoplastic one, or last but not the least are the drugs. Among the infectious etiology, it could be either bacterial that I have enumerated here, or it can be mycobacterial. So particularly in a country like India, definitely it's a strong suspicion. And among protozoa, it could be Leishmania or Toxoplasma. And among fungal etiology, it could be Histoplasma, Aspergillosis, Blastomycosis, or Hepatosplenic Candidiasis. And among viral possibility, it could be either CMV or EBV. And if we talk about primary liver disease, that the primary bilirubinosis can also be a possibility also for granulomatous hepatitis. And among inflammatory disorder, any kind of connective tissue disease or a vasculitic disorder or sarcoidosis can also be a possibility also for granulomatous hepatitis. And among the neoplastic disorder, lymphoma can be a possibility also. And there are so many drugs also that can also cause this kind of disease. And few of them I have enlisted here. So our patient was not on any kind of prolonged medication, and also if we talk about primary biliary cirrhosis, that it usually doesn't present like this kind of a subacute febrile illness. Apart from that, there was nothing, any kind of clinical manifestation. And similarly, if we talk about inflammatory disorder per se in a patient of subacute febrile illness along with no pulmonary and no joint or skin and ocular manifestations, So difficult to think about these inflammatory disorders except sarcoidosis. So here we were able to rule out a few of these possible etiology except the infectious etiology. So keeping all these things in mind, we went ahead with a few more investigations to narrow down our infectious possibility. So in other investigation, we sent that the Brucella serology along with the Coxsella serology, and we repeated CMV and EBV PCR along with the repeated blood culture and urine culture with RK39 and CD4 counts. So everything was found to be completely normal. So after ruling out the possible infectious etiology, we were left with either it can be a mycobacterial disease, that was already a strong suspicion, or it could be histoplasma, but it's kind of a rare disease, or it can be lymphoma or sarcoidosis. So finally, we were left with our four possible differentials, that one of them is the tuberculosis that can be disseminated or abdominal one, or lymphoma or sarcoidosis or histoplasmosis. So then to further narrow down our differentials, patient actually was planned to get a PET CT done. Now I would like to invite Dr. Deekra Ma'am from Nuclear Medicine to discuss the PET CT findings.
Good afternoon, everyone. These are the FDG PET CT images of the patient. The maximum intensity projection images shows that there is physiological tracer uptake in the brain and also physiological renal excretion. There is diffuse increased radio tracer uptake in the liver as well as in the spleen. In case of the liver, the uptake is almost equivalent to that of the brain. This shows that there is definitely increased abnormal tracer uptake in the liver. And also there is mildly increased tracer uptake in the bone marrow. These are the serial PET CT transaxial images showing that there are no focal structural lesions in the liver. And on craniocaudal measurement, we found out there was hepatomegaly and splenomegaly. In the lower images, the blue arrow shows that there was a pre-caval lymph node. Including all the findings, the differential diagnosis that we provided were neoplastic cause like lymphoma or infectious diseases like tuberculosis or fungal infection. So PET-CT has a whole body modality can be used to assess the extent of the disease. And especially in this case, since there was molecular changes coming before any structural lesions, we can also use it for response assessment post-treatment. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So based on the PET-CT findings, actually the patient was planned to get an ultrasound-guided percutaneous liver biopsy. And now I would like to invite Dr. Anju Ma'am from the pathology department to discuss the histopathology findings.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is the microscopic image of the liver biopsy we received. The scanner view is showing multiple cores of hepatic parenchyma. On low power, we can see the liver is there is diffuse infiltration of liver by inflammatory cells along with multiple epithelial cell granulomas involving both lobules as well as the portal tracts. This is the higher power image of an epithelial cell granuloma involving the portal tract and an epithelial cell granuloma in the lobule. We can see histiocytes, lymphocytes, and plasma cells in this. On further higher power magnification, we can see there are within the hepatocytes, there are some intracellular negative shadows as seen here, which are predominantly in clumps. On special stains, these are getting highlighted in the periodic acid chef as pink ovoid bodies. This is the silver methanamine stain. Here also we can see the ovoid bodies getting highlighted. This is the Alcyon blue PAS stain. Here we can see the ovoid bodies with a central dot. This is further getting further special stain, the Fontana Mason stain. Here also we are finding this brown colored ovoid bodies. So we have an intracellular ovoid bodies, possibly fungus, morphologically suggestive of a histoplasma. This is the reticulin stain highlighting the absence of reticulin, which are the epithelial cell granulomas, and these organisms are also getting highlighted. So on the basis of this, we suggested the diagnosis of a granulomatous hepatitis due to histoplasma.
Thank you, ma'am. So interestingly, when we again readmitted the patient after the liver biopsy report for the treatment part, What we found out that there were deranged renal functions along with the hypercalcemia. So this AKI part basically most likely because of hypercalcemia only. And along with there were suppressed IPTS levels. So it was basically PTS independent hypercalcemia, most likely because of granulomatous disease only. And meanwhile, the patient was also started on amphotericin B on the evening of 11. And after three doses of amphotericin B, we found out that there was significant improvement in the serum calcium level along with the creatinine level. So after all these, we finally made a diagnosis of progressive disseminated histoplasmosis with the granulomatous hepatitis and hypercalcemia and the AKI part. Now I'd like to invite Adil sir for the discussion of a few important points regarding the histoplasma. Thank you.
Thank you, Karthik. Moving on to the discussion of the case highlighted some important features, so I would like to mention a few of those. So just to give you the background regarding histoplasmosis, it's a dimorphic fungus which thrives in moist and nitrogen rich soil. The peculiar characteristic is it is found particularly within the upper 15 centimeters of soil. So any earthquakes or construction building, it will lead to aerosolization of microconidia and lead to exposure of the persons who are doing construction work. And regarding Indian scenario, that histoplasmosis is peculiarly found in Indo-Gangetic plains, particularly in West Bengal. You will have UP, Delhi, Punjab. Now, occasional case reports have been reported from all over the India, but these are the areas which have been particularly afflicted with histoplasmosis. So if you see, this is the data from India. This is the decade-wide data from India. First case report was mentioned it was published in 1954. If you say there's a large jump in cases from 2004, and there's a huge rise in cases from 2004 onwards to 2013, and this is the data till 2018. So until then, around 386 cases have been published in India, and all of those, majority of those have been from 2014 onwards. And highest number has been reported presently till now, it has been from West Bengal, followed by UP, Delhi, Rajasthan, Maharashtra, and Bihar. But now cases have been reported from South India also, as well as Eastern India. But predominantly, it used to be North India or Northeastern India. And this is one of the literature reviews done from our institute only by Gupta et al. One of the authors is Dr. Gagandeep also. So if you see, how does the host come into play with regard to the presentation of histoplasmosis? So you see immunocompetent patients and immunocompromised patients. You see the characteristic of the involvement, adrenal involvement, lipidopathy, weight loss, and cutaneous lesion, the outcome. There is significant difference between the two groups. Adrenal involvement being more common, as was reported in this literature, being more common in immunocompetent patients. While you see lipidopathy and cutaneous lesion, they are more favoring the immunocompromised group, and the outcome is usually as expected, more slightly on the worse side in the compromised group. So in the same study, the maximum number of cases were reported from these are the areas, West Bengal, then Uttar Pradesh, also from Punjab and Delhi. So how common is isolated granulomatous hepatitis? Histoplasmosis presenting as granulomatous hepatitis, how common it has been observed in the literature? And there are multiple case reports which have been reported till now. Only case reports have been observed, and they go way back. The first case report on granulomatous hepatitis due to histoplasmosis was in 1970. And after that, it sort of dried up. And last few years, it has been recently reported in dating back to 2009 and also till 2021. What is peculiar and what is important about these case reports, that I will highlight those general theme about these cases. It predominantly affects middle-aged adults, which are probably involved in more outgoing activities, so road construction site workers. And the presentation of granulomatous hepatitis due to histoplasmosis has been acute to subacute. Usually it presents with a fever of unknown origin for around 2 weeks to 6 weeks duration. And patients are more likely to have an underlying impaired cell-mediated immunity. If you see the case reports, they will all, majority of them have impaired cell-mediated immunity. They are either on steroids, they are on conventional DMARDs, or they have an underlying condition which predisposes them to histoplasmosis. They are post-renal transplant, they are post-liver transplant, they are on biologicals. Interestingly, our patient, as mentioned by Karth, he did not have any impaired underlying immunocompromising condition. And biochemical parameters are variable. You'll see case reports where biochemical parameters may be normal and biochemical parameters will be raised. And predominantly, if they are abnormal, ALP is usually more than AST and ALT. So how do you treat progressive disseminated histoplasmosis with the background of granulomatous hepatitis? So any histoplasmosis which is outside the pulmonary system is considered by IDSA as progressive disseminated histoplasmosis, and any progressive all patients with PDH, they need to be treated. If you leave PDH untreated, the acute PDH is usually fatal over a course of 3 months. Chronic PDH usually has a fluctuating course. There will be periods of symptom-free period, but ultimately the course is fatal. So all patients, they need to be treated. And patients who are sufficiently ill to require hospitalization, the drug of choice is liposomal amphotericin B. If patient does not have CNS involvement, so usually a dosage of 3 mg per kg, use it. If patients with CNS involvement, so you will use a higher dosage of 5 mg per kg because the course of CNS involvement is usually fulminant. So once the patient shows response to treatment, then the patient is shifted to itraconazole. And the response to treatment is usually quick with amphotericin B therapy. You will expect a response within 7 days after initiation therapy. So primarily the patient's appetite improves, patient's fever starts to defervesce. And once defervescence occurs, patient is shifted to itraconazole therapy. And you have many formulations of itraconazole which you can use in such patients. May it be itraconazole capsule or itraconazole solution or the newer formulation of itraconazole, which is the Suba itraconazole. So what is the duration of therapy in these patients? The optimal duration remains unknown as of now. So guidelines mention minimum duration of 1 year, but on a case-to-case basis, the duration can be prolonged depending on the patient's baseline risk of relapse of histoplasmosis. So if a patient has impaired cell-mediated immunity, patient is immunocompromised, you will give a more prolonged duration of therapy to prevent relapse. So what if a patient does not respond to itraconazole or patient has an allergic reaction to itraconazole? So we have alternatives to itraconazole. So out of these, fluconazole and voriconazole are not the preferred drugs for histoplasmosis. Patients on fluconazole, they usually develop resistance to fluconazole, which is cross-resistant to voriconazole. So preferred alternatives to itraconazole in the present era are posaconazole, and now the upcoming is isavuconazole also. So these are the preferred alternatives to itraconazole if one is not able to use itraconazole. And one, how does one monitor response to treatment? If available, if urinary antigen is available, one can monitor response to therapy along with the clinical and biochemical parameters. You can monitor with urinary antigen or serum antigen. Because the level is fall with effective treatment, the level is usually decline, and there is a rapid decline within the first 3 months. So if the patient's urinary antigen levels do not fall within the first 3 months, you usually declare as a non-responder, you might change therapy. And for patients who have responded to the treatment, you continue monitoring after you have started, after you have stopped the therapy, and you continue it for 1 to 2 years to detect relapses. So if we have just an overview of granulomatous liver disease, there are multiple etiologies of granulomatous liver disease as shown by Dr. Karthik. But what have case series over the past several decades, what have case series shown? So these are several case series going back from 1966 to 1995, which was reported from India. So majority of the individuals turned out to have tuberculosis, sarcoidosis, or primary biliary cirrhosis. So there is a difference between primary hepatic granulomas and hepatic granulomas with inflammation. So if you have hepatic granulomas with inflammation, that turns out to be granulomatous hepatitis, and usually it is either infectious disease or inflammatory disorders. And if you have isolated hepatic granulomas, it is usually other systemic inflammatory disorders or primary liver disease. And based on pathology, one can try to differentiate based on pathology. If you have typical granulomas, you might have epithelioid granulomas on one end, or spiratory granulomas on other end, or fibrinary granulomas, or lipid-rich granulomas. So one can have a clue from that side also. So this case also highlighted that what is the use of liver biopsy in patients who present with fever of unknown origin. So in patients where the imaging is negative, the liver biopsy has a yield of around 14 to 16%. So that is derived from several retrospective case series which have been published over the years. One of these case series was from Vanderbilt University of 43 cases. The yield was 13%, and a retrospective series was from Michigan University where the yield was 16%. But one thing to be noted that this is a single center studies. These are reference institution, and there is a huge referral bias. So one might not see the same in a primary care setting or in a unselected patients of fever of unknown origin. So take home messages from this case were that granulomatous hepatitis, it continues to remain a common cause of fever of unknown origin. What proportion of patients FUO they have underlying granulomatous, it is difficult to estimate with the current evidence base which is there. And in patients with FUO, liver biopsy still has a fair diagnostic yield if you have imaging which is not suggestive of anything, but we have biochemical parameters which give a suspicion of granulomatous hepatitis, liver biopsy has a fair yield with low complication rates. And in TB endemic countries, histoplasmosis is often misdiagnosed, which leads to inappropriate empirical therapy, because the empirical therapy of tuberculosis is primary, entirely different from histoplasmosis. And if you go on treating in the lines of tuberculosis, you will entirely miss out histoplasmosis. And given the rapidly progressive course, the outcome is usually fatal within 4 to 8 weeks. And it's the same that early recognition and treatment of acute PDH is key, given its ultimately fatal course. It's rapidly progressive disease. And this was highlighted in our patient also, that this patient did not, in between he had to undergo liver biopsy, he did not receive treatment, so we did not have a diagnosis of histoplasmosis. So in that period of time, he developed moderate hypercalcemia along with acute renal injury, which suggests the chronic, which suggests the progressive nature of the disease. And granulomatous conditions, they can present, this is one of the important points to remember, that granulomatous conditions can present with varying severity of hypercalcemia at any stage of the, be it in the early in the disease or be it in the later stage, they can present with hypercalcemia. And it is to be recognized in our country predominantly, because several granulomatous diseases are prominent in our country, tuberculosis, histoplasmosis, be it sarcoidosis. So we should be cognizant of this association of granulomatous disease with hypercalcemia. Thank you.
Thank you, Adil and Karthik. So basically, why we have brought this case is to highlight that histoplasmosis is one of the less common infections, but it very closely, the disseminated form of the disease very closely mimics tuberculosis. So often patients are empirically started on ATT. But there are certain points which may point towards histoplasmosis more as compared to tuberculosis, like involvement of skin and mucous membrane, involvement of the adrenal glands, involvement of bone marrow leading to pancytopenia. It's more likely in case of histoplasmosis. However, still tuberculosis still remains the first differential diagnosis in these situations also, but histoplasmosis should always be kept in mind when we are dealing with these situations. And it is a very fatal but readily treatable infection, so it should never be missed. So that's why we brought this case. So I would like to invite questions and comments from the audience.
Because, you know, when the patient came, probably we already had an inkling that the patient is having granulomatous hepatitis, but PET scan helped us in localizing the disease to the liver. Done a liver biopsy PET scan? Yes, probably I would have also done it the same way. Question is...
So basically, PET scan helps us in pointing out the dissemination of the disease first. So this was a localized disease. Secondly, liver biopsy may be more invasive as compared to a lymph node biopsy if we could have had some lymph node identifiable on PET scan.
One of the DD was lymphoma. You are forgetting. One of the DD was lymphoma. And for lymphoma diagnosis, PET scan is the best. You can identify the node, you can tell which node can be amenable for biopsy and all this. But in this patient, there was a diffuse hepatomegaly, and normally liver, you know, the phosphatase enzyme is there in the liver. So you don't see very high uptake in the liver compared to a spleen. There was inflammatory pathology, the liver, whole liver was involved. There was massive hepatomegaly, and which in CT and MR, not showing the structural counterpart, whereas functionally liver was very much active. And there was a solitary lymph node present. That's what suspicion, what could it be? But looking at the scan, it was the first inflammatory pathology. I told you that lymphoma, tuberculosis, and sarcoidosis can never be diagnosed from a PET scan. It is the histopathology which will tell. So this is what, if you see a identifiable lymph, suppose you get an inguinal node which you never suspected, and you found a big node in the inguinal region, you can get the biopsy done. Get axillary node, that those are the sites which PET helps. PET never gives any diagnosis. Most of the imaging condition, you never get a diagnosis. You get where to take the biopsy. field radiologies.
And moreover,
there are very pathognomonic radiology condition where you can make the diagnosis from image, but most of the time it helps you how to take the biopsy.
Moreover, this patient was obese also, so we had like maybe he has fatty liver or something, and whether we are doing the right organ, unnecessarily invading someone with important investigation was a little.
Oncological workup, two conditions which you do next in the PET scan. One is PO, the other is paraneoplastic syndrome. We do 100 paraneoplastic syndrome, we pick up only 3 or 4 malignant condition producing paraneoplastic syndrome. But in a few pyrexia upon non origin, we pick up around 40 to 50% of the cases.
But calcium levels were always normal in the initial part of the disease.
Sir, it could in have fluctuating. Possible that chronic histoplasma had a fluctuating course with different episodes of hypercalcium.
Yeah. Fluctuating course is known in histoplasmosis. This is possible. No lung lesion, isolated involvement of liver and now secondarily spleen also. Yeah.
The adrenal, then probably goes to the liver. So liver, lung is the most common site in involvement.
But still, the possibility remains. We cannot with.
So don't have it in the any other organ system. My question was between itraconazole and amphotericin B. The guideline says that if the patient is ill enough to be admitted, but your patient was not admitted. You admitted him for amphotericin B. Any reason for not choosing to go ahead with itraconazole therapy?
No, patient was admitted. Patient had hypercalcemia. So that is one of the severe form of the disease if is happening, right? Because that is, in fact, renal functions are deteriorated because of hypercalcemia. So amphotericin B was the first choice.
Yeah, sure. No, I mean, it's a blurry line. There have been times when we have chosen itraconazole and patients have improved. And there are, I can understand a situation where you might choose to start with amphotericin B. And the other point you've also made that the duration of treatment is not fixed. Sometimes a minimum 1 year is what people say. Are you going to be following him up with antigen testing, or is that available
antigen
with us?
Antigen testing is available sometimes intermittently. Dr. Gagandeep can highlight more on this.
Yes, certainly, sir. I will ask you questions too, if you are feeling left out.
Thank you.